And joining us now on Hot Coffee, we have the chairperson of the Senate Committee on Local Government, Senator J.V. Ejercito. Senator J.V., good morning to you, sir.
Yes, Karen, good morning. Nice to be back in your show. Good morning to all the televiewers and followers of Head Start.
All right. Let's start first. I want your reaction on Congressman Arnie Tevez being in the United States right now. Of course, an overview for the audience. A murder complaint was filed against him, but not for Degamo's killing. It was for killings in Negros Oriental in 2019. But those complaints came out after the Degamo murder. What are your thoughts first on Congressman Tevez being out of the country?
Well, I'm hoping that he comes home as soon as possible and face the music. If he is indeed not guilty, then there is nothing that he should be worried about. And because of him being in the United States, a lot of people are speculating that, there's a saying that flight means guilt, or just before the fatal ambush of Governor Degamo, it was a coincidence that he was there in the U.S. So he has to come home and face all the cases that are being filed against him.
All right. Now, let's talk about the death of Governor Degamo. There have been descriptions before describing it as an isolated incident. But given that there were 2019 killings as well in Negros Oriental, how would you describe the peace and order situation in Negros Oriental and the political landscape?
Well, you know, Karen, I've been in the Senate. I've been a national official since 2013. And from what I know, my mother comes from Negros Occidental. Mm-hmm. Oriental is just adjacent. And from what I know, it used to be a very peaceful province. No, in fact, Dumaguete is a university town. It's a center for tourism, for education. And it's really sad that the situation has really changed in the recent years. So, and you know, Karen, I am personally affected because Governor Roel Degamo is a very good friend of Senate President Mitsubiri, Majority Floor Leader Joel Villarreal, and myself. We went there because every time I think about what happened to him, the kind of sadness I feel is really different because he's really a very good man. No? In fact, he's not security conscious, as you can see. By the manner the assailants entered this house, there were no security. Only one reported, I think, for that day. That's another issue. But I don't. Governor Degamo doesn't deserve this kind of death. We want justice for what has happened to him. And when we went there, Karen, just to narrate, you can see the sadness in the province, as reflected upon the faces of the people that were there when we went to the wake. So I'm hoping that justice can be served once and for all. Because Karen, this is a black eye, not only for Negros, but for the whole country. Because, you know, the president has been going around the different countries, marketing the country, saying that we are now open for business. And then this comes along. So I'm hoping that as soon as possible, justice can be served the soonest possible time. And Karen, being the chairman of the Committee on Local Government, I'm very concerned because just this year, 9 spate of killings and ambushes, no, from Governor Degamo, Governor Adyong, luckily he survived, but the Vice Mayor Roel Alameda of Cagayan was killed. Mayor Datu Montawal was injured. Mayor Rose Furigay was killed. Vice Mayor Romeo Sulit of Lobo, Batangas, and others, no, were killed. So there were 9 killings already of local officials this year. So there's really a need for the Philippine National Police to step up in the law for enforcement agencies because, Karen, whatever they provide, even the controversial intelligence fund, we fought for it, for their budget, and they should not use it. And I think, Karen, just on this issue, there was really a failure of intelligence on the part of the regional and the provincial and even the local police offices in Negros Oriental, because how can something so brazen, having a private army trained also probably in Negros Oriental, having all of these sophisticated weapons, hindi pipitsukin to, talagang you can see the weapons are really sophisticated and very expensive. And I would say that with the movement of the assailants, they were trained, no, very coordinated, no, for the close quarter battle training.
Okay, now let's talk about two points here. One is you being the chairman of the local government committee in the Senate, and the other is the Degamo case itself. So let's go to the Degamo case itself. You've already weighed in and you said an investigation must be conducted as well, because 5 out of 6 personnel that were usually guarding Governor Degamo were not present during the time that the assailants actually entered the compound. And I think that was a very good observation. How could 5 or 6 of his own bodyguards be absent during the actual day of the killing? And parang maraming tao nun eh, no, sa compound niya. Ito yung araw na, kumbaga, his constituents were engaged with him, humihingi ng tulong.
Yes, that is correct, Karen. This was confirmed by Secretary Boying Rimulya, that indeed 5 out of 6 of his security detail were absent at that fatal day. And considering, Karen, that it was People's Day, no, for Degamo, that the public, the his compound is open to the public. He talks to the people every weekend. Security around. So you saw the video. That there was virtually no resistance at all, no, from the security men, because only one security personnel assigned to him, his cousin at that, was present, no, who reported to work. So that is another angle, and I would surmise, Karen, that the regional, provincial, and even the local police officers in Region 8 are already compromised, no, because of this circumstance, so that they have to be investigated as well.
Okay, so one is it's a possible conspiracy. Do you believe that a politician could be the mastermind of this killing?
Well, it's I do not want to make any judgment or conclusion while the investigation is ongoing, Karen, but one thing is for sure, that the assassination of Governor Degamo was well funded. Again, you can see the weapons that were used were really expensive weapons. No, the ex-military who conducted the killing were well trained, and I would say that they were in training for a few months, considering that they were really synchronized, coordinated, and really experts in close quarter battle. Iba yung galaw nila eh. Kitang-kita mo na they are really specialists, no? So this has probably been this training and having private armed group has been in existence in Negros Oriental for the past months, and it's very impossible for the police, no, for the regional, provincial, and even local police not to know that this has been going on. So I would say that the police officers from the regional and provincial levels are compromised.
Okay. So should they be replaced? Should they be relieved? Should they be reassigned?
From what I gathered, Karen, we were briefed by the Philippine National Police officials when we arrived there with Senate President Ming Zubiri, that that is what they will do. But that's 1,900, we're talking about 1,900 police personnel, Karen, so that will not be easy. So they will do it by waves. Probably they will start from the top and then slowly change and reassign others and reorient, no, all the other police officers in Dumaguete. So it's a tough task, but I think that that is what they're planning to do.
But you strike a very good point there. With 1,900 police officers in the area, is that correct? In that particular region, yes. And intelligence funds be given out to the local governments, why is it that they were not able to actually deter the killing? Why didn't they get information that there was this kind of planning? And why didn't they even provide security for the governor during that particular day?
Well, that is all of those circumstances, Karen, already probably already the DOJ and other investigative agencies have already good information on what really happened. But what thing is for sure, it's really impossible for the police not to even know or smell that something is going on. Having private armed groups, you will already, I'm sure, malalaman na nila in barangay, presence of private armed groups will be impossible not to notice. But to have a training of this kind, Karen, happening in your region with 1,900 personnel with intelligence fund.
Yeah.
So those are the questions that I have in mind, and it's really it's easy to say that I think the whole police force in the region in the province is compromised already.
Okay. Now, just recently, the armed forces sent a 50-man elite team to Negros Oriental. They're supposed to actually, support the investigation of the PNP. They're also after other suspects involved in the military. I know four of them were former military men. I believe four of the five suspects arrested. Ang tanong dito, is this the way to go? To put 50 elite military men around Negros Oriental. Is this the solution, Senator?
Well, Karen, based on my conversations in the short trip that we had to visit Governor Degamos wake, people are really in fear right now the situation. So I think this is an extreme option that the military and the police has to take right now, just to maintain peace and order, and really to disband whatever private armies or are left, yung remnants, all of them has to be arrested. So not until all of those assailants are already in custody, probably then they can already ease the attention and ease the operations right now, though. But I would agree. And I with the actions of the PNP and AFP now, that they really have to crack down on and restore peace and order, and to get back the confidence not only of other people, because not only of tourists, investors, but more of the local constituents of Negros Oriental.
Okay. Now, Senator, you being the chairman of the Committee on Local Government, just I think last week, President Marcos Jr., he described it as shocking, purely political, and he ordered the dismantling of private armies to the DILG and the PNP. The irony is, this isn't new, diba? Ang tagal mo ng senador, ang tagal ko ng broadcaster. Let's not forget the Maguindanao massacre. After the Maguindanao massacre, there was a crackdown. There was an order to dismantle private armies. Senator, what has happened? You just mentioned nine political, at least harassments, acts of violence in the recent year, right? Ano nangyari? We've already tried to dismantle private armies before.
Well, Karen, I have to be honest because I go around the country as well. I go on my motorcycle, I bike a lot in my engagements. I would say there's considerable improvement right now. That like when you go to Mindanao, Karen, right now, before when you go to the lobbies of hotel, wow, there's a lot of politicians are surrounded with fully armed bodyguards. Mm-hmm. But now you don't see that anymore. Not much, probably. Very few, but not much anymore. So I would say that this incident in Negros Oriental is just one, not isolated, or just a very few remnants of people having their own private armies. But I would say there's considerable improvement, and already, as I mentioned, Mindanao, if when you go there, it's really wild west. Talagang everybody had a gun in the lobbies, but you don't see that anymore. So I'm hoping that with this very few private armies that are left, I'm hoping that with the president's instruction, that's already policy that I hope that the PNP, the AFP would join hands already in dismantling all of these private armies.
Or do you believe, Senator, that the culture and the modus has changed? Maybe put it to 20 years ago, 15 years ago, politicians in rural areas had private armies, but now it's gun for hire. Do you believe ganun na ang nangyayari ngayon?
Well, yes, that is correct, Karen. And as I would agree with the President that most of these killings recently involving attempted ambush on government officials are all politically motivated, no? As you mentioned. And that's why we really have, the police really has to step up on this gun for hire. Ano, napakamura na ng ano ngayon, tari ng buhay. I heard sometimes 10,000, 50,000. You can already contract these people. And we're also looking at, because the age of retirement of armed forces and PNP personnel is 56. It's very young. Batang-bata pa. So the AFP and PNP has to monitor and probably would have a program on giving livelihood, not only the pension, on their whereabouts after. Dapat meron ding study kung anong ginagawa nila. Because as you observe, Karen, in this Degamo killing, I think half of the assailants are ex-military officials.
And dishonorably discharged, apparently.
Yes.
Go on.
Tama. Yeah. So I think especially those, Karen, that were discharged or dishonorably discharged, that means they have a problem, no? They should be monitored by the AFP also. Kasi sila po yung madalas na kinukuhang mga gun for hire, or these are the people that are also involved in a lot of crimes. So those are dishonorably discharged. So that means that they really have a problem in character, probably, psychological problem. They should be monitored, no? Hindi lang yung basta pinaalis na lang, dishonorably discharged, but they should be monitored. Because I would say that they have a problem as a person.
Okay. Now, quite interesting, in 2016, when former President Duterte just came into office, observers and critics have said that he was silent on private armies of politicians, and it wasn't really a priority during his term. But there's been, as some observers said, an escalation of violence in when it comes to political killings during the last administration. Do you believe that we've moved towards going back to the old cultural ways of political violence? Because now you have President Marcos Jr. clearly, who's in shock that this still happens today, because it is 2023 when you think about it. Have we moved back culturally, Senator JV? Is this a deeper problem we're facing?
Well, Karen, I'm also puzzled, no? Because this year, I'm really surprised that one killing, one or attempts on lives of government officials have been happening. The data I have right now is from 2022 to 2023, there are 9. July of 2022 up to this time, there were 9 attempts, and more than half were killed. So I am really a cause for concern and cause for alarm, because this will not paint a very good picture of the country. As I mentioned earlier, the president has been trying hard to market the Philippines all over the world as an investment, as a tourism destination. But with these political killings, I think this is a black eye on the country's image. So the Philippine National Police, the AFP, all the law enforcement agencies really has to step up. Again, controversial nga yung naging intelligence fund during the budget deliberations. I'm hoping that they put this into good use. Gamitin nila ito. Nasaan napunta yun? Pinaglaban namin yan para magamit nyo. And I'm very, very disappointed that there was failure of intelligence in Negros Oriental, considering that all of the things that they asked. Ako, I personally, Karen, during the Duterte administration, I was the one defending the budget of the Philippine National Police. And even when I went back, I supported their budget, all of the things that they need to make sure that peace and order is restored in the country. So I am somewhat disappointed that this had to happen to Negros. Again, it's a failure of intelligence. Asan yung ginamit yung intel fund nyo? No? It's probably it's a failure of intelligence. Maaring meron dyan nagbulag-bulagan o talagang sinadyang lumabo ang mata. So this has, those people have to be probed as well. And Karen, one more thing, no? I would like to add, I received information that when warrants were supposed to be served, there were some police officers that say that parang baliwala naman yan, parang they refused to serve the warrant. So people
why
from the central
that?
Office.
Why is that? Can you explain that? You mean they refused to serve the warrant?
Well, they were having alibis. I received information. So, of course, Justice Secretary had to do something and ask with the Secretary Abalos that people from headquarters from the central office had to go to Negros so that they will serve the warrants. Karen.
Oh, okay. So I think that says a lot of the situation in Negros Oriental, what you just pointed out. And I wanted to ask you, what would you want the DILG secretary? You know, Benhur Abalos is an expert, as many would say, in the local government sector. I mean, when he was mayor of Mandaluyong and when he was MMDA chairman, actually, he fought for banning the riding in tandem policy, right? That got a lot of controversy then, but he stood his ground and said, banning riding in tandem leads to zero crime, right? In their particular area. So, you know, Benhur Abalos is a guy that's done, I would have to say he's quite creative and he's revolutionary in some of the ideas, whether or not one would agree with him, even the resignation of police officers, right? The courtesy resignation. What would you want him to do with this time? Because he's still preoccupied, you have to face it. May problema pa doon sa drug situation wherein pina-resign ang mga police officers and then there's a task force reviewing each police officer. Tas eto na naman.
Well, I would say that the experience of Secretary Benhur Abalos can help a lot, no, in restoring peace and order. With, as you mentioned, he is innovative. Medyo controversial nga yung banning riding in tandem. Yeah. What is only allowed, no? What is only allowed to ride are the family members or couples.
Yes. Yeah.
So, ako, that's very sensitive, controversial, but I think there's some sense into it because usually those who are involved in ambushes or other crimes are those who are using motorcycles. Yung mga nagra-riding in tandem. And most, I don't think a lot of people would react because most Filipinos already have motorcycles. In fact, lahat yan may sarili ng motorsiklo eh. So, bihira na rin yung nagra-riding in tandem na both male, no? In fact, Karen, when I see someone, because I don't use bulletproof, I bike on my own on the street. When I see two males in motorcycles, I'm worried. Tinitingnan ko na rin yun, no? Because of my security concern. So I would say that's a good idea.
That's what
Secretary Abalos
did in Mandaluyong. How do we move it forward now to the acts of violence and killings in the provinces? Because clearly this would still be under Secretary Abalos's purview.
Well, probably you can consider that, no? I'm sure that there will be reactions, but I think we just have to do something. We have to go to the extreme option already, Karen, yeah. Because we really do not want all the efforts of the president to go into waste, no? Going all around the world, marketing the Philippines. But these political killings has to stop because it paints a very bad picture of the country. Kahit anong trabaho natin dito, however we market, no, the country, but with this incidents, that certainly leaves a very bad image to the country. So I think we, the Secretary Abalos and the other law enforcement agencies has to go to the extreme option already. And I think what he did in Mandaluyong, banning riding in tandem of two male riders, is a good idea, no? To look into. Kasi okay. Lahat naman kare, I'm a rider myself. Yeah. Almost all Filipinos have their own motorcycles already.
Yeah. Okay. I have two more issues to ask you, but just very quickly, your colleagues are already calling for an investigation on political killings in general, and also the specific case of the Degamo killing. What's the latest on that? Is it scheduled, Senator?
Yes, actually, Karim, there was a supposed Senate investigation this week, no, by the Committee on Public Order and Safety under Senator Bato de la Rosa. But he postponed it, no, and I support his decision. While the investigations are ongoing, we do not want to preempt the ongoing investigation on the issue. So probably that's a good call on the part of Senator Bato to postpone the hearing so that the investigative agencies, the DOJ, NBI, the police can do their work first before we go into a public hearing to investigate the latest incident.
Yeah, and I think it's good for the Senate to investigate where the intelligence funds went and how it was spent, right?
That is correct, Karen, because as you know, this controversial intelligence fund were discussed and became a hot issue during the budget hearings last year. And especially for the PNP, for the AFP, we fought and we supported their request. So I'm really disappointed, being one of those who really support the PNP through the years, that the cause of this incident of which resulted in the fatal killing of Governor Degamo is really, I would say, it's really failure of intelligence. So paano nila ginamit to? And I think the Senate has to exercise its oversight function this time on how they are using the intelligence fund that was given to them.
All right, another issue. Let's talk about charter change. Senator Robin Padilla, the committee chairman on constitutional amendments, says more than half of the senators actually support charter change. Now, you do know the lower house is pushing for a constitutional convention. Where does Senator J.V. Ejercito stand on this, both on charter change and the manner?
Well, Karen, I have to be honest with you, no, that the Constitution was written in 1987, and the world has changed in the recent years. No, at the time the Constitution was written, there was no such thing as a World Wide Web, no internet then, no globalization. I think we have to really review and make the Constitution. We have to adapt to the current situation already, so that the country, the Philippines, can be competitive compared to its ASEAN neighbors. But Karen, I am just worried, as well as with other senators, that we are probably, we will support the economic provisions. But what the danger is, that if we go on a CONCON or a CONAC, we will now be opening up the Constitution. So anything goes. No?
That's CONCON.
Amended, the whole thing.
CONCON. Okay.
Yes. So that is the that is what we are really worried about, because we do not want to touch the political provisions or the political aspect, because that's very, very controversial. And I guess the Filipino people or the public has already accepted the political system that we had.
Okay.
So if they can assure that it will really be only the economic provisions, then I might be straight to support, no,
the CONCON.
The cha-cha. Yes, the CONCON.
The cha-cha. Okay. No, yes. Pero ang tanong nito, Senator, just very quickly. So if it's a constitutional convention, you'd have to vote for delegates, right? The public will vote for delegates. And according to Congressman Rufus Rodriguez, lawmakers will no longer have control on what the delegates want to change. So at one point, I know Senator Robin Padilla was saying it's logical to make it a constituent assembly, CONAS, so both houses can agree, or economic provisions. conditions lang tayo. But Congressman Rufus Rodriguez said that will be so unpopular to the public. So what do you believe? What is best? Because a lot of you generally feel that it's time to tweak some of the economic provisions.
Well, Karen, if we go on as it's cheaper because both houses will act as the constitutional assembly. But the only problem there, Karen, is that I don't think the Senate, yung controversy dyan is how do we vote? Do we vote as one or do we vote as a separate houses? And if we, of course, the senators are worried because we will be drowned because we are only 24 against 300. So that is one issue that has to be resolved in case it will be a constituent assembly, whether we vote as one or voting separately. Doon naman sa CONCON, ang ano naman natin, apprehension, Karen, is that, yeah, they will be elected, they will be separate from houses, but how should we that those who will be running or be for the CONCON as delegates will not be relatives or people of politicians. So yun po yung mga... Yun walang naman ang nandat sa CONCON. Walang ban eh.
Walang
so,
ban. Oo.
Yes. So that is the apprehension of some people that ganun din yun eh. Nakita nyo naman sa party list, di ba? Ganun din yun. Some of the party list are also relatives of politicians. So baka yun din ang mangyari with the CONCON that politicians will have their own delegates. For representing their districts.
Okay, now the irony is while you are open to change the economic provisions, you've recently just called out that maybe it's possible to take back the NGCP, this is the National Grid Corporation of the Philippines partnership with the State Grid Corporation of China. So the State Grid Corporation of China has a 40% stake in NGCP, and the Constitution provides that it should just have a 40% stake. So here is Senator JV, you are open to economic tweaking, but you want to even take back the 40% stake, which would make it all Filipino. So some may ask, ano ba si Senator JV? Is he more liberal and global? Or technically, does he even want stricter, right? Stricter ownership rules when it comes to industries, because by making that statement, you believe that NGCB should be fully Filipino, or is it just that you don't want it to be China?
No, Karen, it's I would say that NGCB, probably yung sa CAAP, all of these entities that matter to national security should be wholly owned and controlled by the state. Yun lang, because of national security matters and issues, Karen. But the others, of course, we have to make our economy be competitive. We have to adapt to the current situation. It's already globalization. We have to be competitive. But I would say, on entities or agencies that have national security, that matter to national security, I would say that this has to be controlled and owned by the state.
All right. On that note, is there anything you'd like to add, Senator JV?
Well, Karen, siguro yung one thing also I would like to add that in the Senate that we are happy with the leadership of Senate President Bingsubiri. There is no truth to the rumor that there's a impending coup attempt. Yes, because I would say, yes, because Karen, you know, the character of the Senate, we really try to... We admit that we are quite slow, no? But we, especially on controversial or important issues, measures, we really scrutinize and really study very hard because these are like the Maharlika bill, for example.
Yes,
we have already had three hearings and we really go to the TWD, go to plenary because we do not want to make a mistake. And you know, we know for a fact that the Senate is called the last bastion of democracy. That's why we really have to do our job. And I'm sure that the president understands this because he came from the Senate. That's why he understands how we move. And I would say that under the leadership of Senate President Bingsubiri, almost all the things that the administration, that the president really prioritized, we were able to pass. But there are just some measures that has to undergo intense scrutiny. So that's what we are doing.
Just very quickly, where do you think is it coming from? The stories of a possible coup against us, the Senate president. Saan kaya ito nangyari?
Well, I'm also surprised about it, Khaled, because if you ask every senator here, everybody is, everybody's happy because the Senate president has been very fair. He has he is very supportive of the administration. But at the same time, Khaled, he has allowed us to maintain our so-called independence, no? On controversial issues, he has told senators, no, we go on a conscience vote. So he doesn't dictate. So he has been very fair. So we are just puzzled as to this issue coming out. And I would say that even the minority leader, kung pwede lang pupoto si ng minority leader Coco Pimentel, I think they would support the Senate president. But also in talking about the minority, they have been very, very fair.
They've been very active. And
very active as well. Yeah. And they have been doing their job as fiscalizer. So, and that is the job of the Senate. And that's the job of the minority. And we appreciate them for doing that, but not to the point of being an obstructionist. We have on controversial measures, it's very easy to talk to them. And they have, in fact, supported some of the measures that of national interest current.
All right. On that note, Senator J.D. Ejercito, thank you for joining me today. It's been a pleasure, sir. I hope to see you again.
Thank you, Karen. As always, it has always been a pleasure.